Welcome to the podcast series on National Education Policy 2020 by the Center of Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. For this podcast, we plan to interview educationists and other stakeholders to share their responses and insights on different chapters of the education policy. Over to our host of today.
Hello listeners, this is Arushi Bansal, your host for the day, and today we will be talking about issues of teachers and teacher deprofessionalization. Our guest of the day is to be Dr. Murari Jha. Murari Jha is a social science teacher in one of the Delhi government schools. Murari is an alumni of Jamia and TISS Mumbai, who has a strong belief in democratic values. He practices critical pedagogy to enable students for a challenging role in the society. He has authored two storybooks that were published by US-based NGO, Room to Read. Jha has written and presented paper at an international conference, CESI. He is the recipient of Teacher Fellowship from Regional Resource Center for Elementary Education and maintains a blog titled ReflectiveDiary.com. Murari at present is working as a mentor teacher in the education department, where he supports his fellow teachers in improving the classroom pedagogy. Murari participated in prestigious Teaching Excellence and Achievement Program during spring 2018, where he visited George Mason University, Virginia, USA. Murari has received a special state award from the Delhi State in 2017 for his contribution in the education sector. Currently, he is also pursuing his PhD. I welcome you, sir. You have been teaching in a government school of Delhi for over a decade. What have been your concerns that you wanted NEP to address?
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been over a decade now teaching in a government school of Delhi. Well, when you talk to teachers, there's a lot of concerns they have. But something which most often you will come across that they want to teach, but they don't get time for it. So there is something fundamental, problem which teachers, I think, across the country, particularly in Indian context, I'll say, they face it. They want to teach, but they don't get time for it. So I think a lot of problem lies within this concern of the teacher. And I was expecting that the policies must address it. Yeah.
Right, sir. NEP 2020 for preparation of initial cadre of teachers in Anganwadis allow workers or teachers with qualification with 10+2 to undergo a 6-month training program, whereas those with lower qualification will undertake a 1-year diploma program. What implications it would have on the status of a teaching as a profession when multiple entry points to the profession are allowed?
Yeah, I think the most important thing here is to understand that how we see the profession of teaching. In fact, this is highly misunderstood. And there is a larger understanding in society that like anyone can teach. If we look at from the democratic principle, the line seems perfectly okay. Yes, anyone can teach. But if we look from the disciplinary boundary of a profession, then the profession requires a certain degree of training, a certain degree of academic knowledge, eligibility, and without fulfilling those trainings, academic knowledge, eligibility, profession has its own boundary and it doesn't allow people to enter into it. Unfortunately, this is not the case with the teaching. In literal sense, you will see people from any walk of life, they enter. They teach may not be informal, but in informal sectors, but they are in the profession of teaching. And what has been informal so far, we see that to a certain extent with such provisions, which NEP is envisaging that the people who are like 10th class pass or 12th class pass, even they can go for a profession of teaching with a particular diploma or degree of six months. What's the problem with this kind of provision is that I'm not saying it. In fact, it has been stated repeatedly in NEP itself that the profession of teaching somewhere fails to attract the best mind of this country, and that everyone knows, and it's a reality. Well, then when you make such provisions that people like with 6 months diploma courses, or those who are 10th class pass, or those who are 5th class pass, they can also enter into the profession of teaching. Do you think that this, with these provisions, people would like to come? The best mind would like to come to the profession of teaching? I think not. If we see the other professions where the best talent wants to go, they are the professions where there are standards, highest standards, and where people spend a lot of time studying, preparing to enter into that profession. So we have to see that by such provisions, we are somewhere diluting that professional boundaries and somewhere legislating around the common feeling of Indian people that anyone can teach. And this, I think, somewhere is not a good move.
Definitely, sir. I agree with you. That is why we have these statements that who cannot do anything, they teach. They enter into the teaching profession. Rightly said, sir.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, there are documentary evidences, and I was reading a paper by Professor Batra, she wrote in 2005 in one of her EPW articles. There also she writes that, people generally see as the bounce back option as the last resort, because they could not get into, the other services. Recently, in fact, I wrote an article on my blog. One unknown person wrote a letter to me. He was working in some government department as section officer. And he wrote to me asking that he got selected for, teaching in a government school. So whether he should leave that job and join teaching or not. And I said, yeah, of course you should. But then he wrote that many of the teachers are saying that there's no, greater chances of promotion. You don't get time to teach. And there's a lot of other work which is not supposed to be done by the teacher. So there are so many things, and people are discouraging me to be a teacher. So what should I do? So, I mean, you imagine a country and how policy is imagining that the best mind should come. So even a section officer is not ready to come and join the profession of teaching. And forget about the people who are aspiring for the IITs, for the medicals, for the legal professions, for civil services. How can we attract them to the profession of teaching? That's a true reality that the people see it as a last resort, and that is unfortunate, I'll say. Yeah.
Definitely, sir. Talking about from the point of progression, when policy explicitly says that progression is stages, in stages is an incentive for progression in career, how valid is it to make such statements? Are we saying that the teachers at primary level are lower in hierarchy or in their knowledge base? What do you think?
Well, it has two angles, and somewhere, since we are the part of a deeply hierarchical society, and so we see everything in terms of, in terms of hierarchy only, that what the career progression is. So suppose if a teacher teaching in the primary classes would be seen as, lower in rank, so moving ahead when they go to the teaching at elementary level, then to secondary and higher secondary level. So this is how the growth is seen. But I'll say that this is perhaps not a good parameter to see the progress in career in the profession of teaching, because each level needs a different set of skills, different set of academic knowledge, different sets of research. And I don't think that one particular sector, whether it is primary, elementary or secondary, are less important or more important than other. Because each segment has its own challenges, and equally qualified people are required. So, but unfortunately, this is not how policy is seeing these things. So, in my opinion, if a person with a master's degree is required to teach the higher secondary classes, I don't think that the person with a diploma is required to teach at primary level. They also need to have masters in the subject they teach, because it needs a lot of skills and a lot of understanding to deal at any level, irrespective of which grade level it is. So we have to somewhere bring a shift, and it is something very interesting which I noticed in Singapore, that irrespective of which grade one teaches, that doesn't determine the position of a teacher, that whether he's a junior in terms of ranks. So like it's equally respectable. So because equal kind of rigorous training are required, whether a person is teaching at primary level or at secondary level. So it's just a like of, I mean, how it can be seen, we can take the example from the field of medicine. So if person is like having a specialization in ortho, or person having a specialization in ENT, these are two different fields. We don't see that one is more important and the other is less important. I think it's like similar thing. So person teaching in primary level are equally important compared to the person teaching at higher secondary level.
So these analogies with different professions really help us to think deeper into how we picture teachers to be. So the policy says, and I quote, "Standards would cover expectations of the role of the teacher at different levels of expertise and the competences required for that stage." What do you think that policy is trying to say here?
See, these are beautiful sentences that at different levels, different kind of competencies and expertise would be required, and perhaps the training of the teachers would cater to these needs. So these are beautiful lines, but what I see and I find is something not getting into sync with what policy states elsewhere, that a person with 12th class pass or 10th class pass and having a diploma, and then at some other level, at secondary level, you need a person with master's degree and then BA degree. So, what you have just stated, it says that yes, each stage need competencies and expertise, but to fulfill those competencies and expertise, we are just kind of suggesting that fine, at some level, we won't require much education. So person with 12th class, degree would be eligible to teach. So somewhere what we are saying at one place, we are contradicting at other places. This is the fact what policy is stating. This, yes, different competencies and skills level are required, but it doesn't mean that it can compromise with essential minimum eligibility. That is, I think whatever it could be, I think, I feel it could have been similar for all, maybe a bachelor's degree or maybe a master's degree, whether a person is teaching at a primary level or at elementary level.
Yes, sir. Taking your response at two levels, one at entry points and one for the degree. Yeah. Policy talks about TET and NET as means of strengthening content and pedagogy amongst teachers. How problematic it is when policy gauges at assessing the motivation and passion of the teacher?
The problem is that if you look at TETs and SETs, NETs, these are the standardized, exams, which basically and the chief aim is to filtration. A lot of teachers are doing B.A.s. And so they need to be filtered. The problem is that any of the objectives which policy tries to achieve through these exams, I don't think are going to be successful, because what we need to do is to look at our teacher training program and the colleges that are providing it. Policy itself mentions that a large number of teacher training programs are under the private organizations, and the quality of teacher training program in such organizations are below average. I mean, it's not I'm telling you, it's the policy which acknowledges. And so, in fact, any kind of intervention has to be made there. And there are provisions, policy is talking about it, that in a due course of time, this has to be fixed. And there cannot be teacher training colleges which would work in isolation. It has to be part of a multidisciplinary universities. Those are something interesting and wonderful things I'll say. It has to be addressed as soon as possible. Nothing, I can't say, but much cannot be achieved through a standardized examination, which is there. It's only a form of filtration in a big country like India, where you know millions of people go in any profession, and then through a standardization, you try to minimize the number. And obviously, any such exams doesn't talk about, or perhaps not capable of, you know, measuring the motivation level or the passion of the teacher. So these are some of the other side of these exams, which I can understand, I think. Yeah.
Yes, sir, it really seems like, how will the policy actually assess the motivation of the passion of the teacher?
Yeah.
Can't
yeah.
really
point yeah.
fingers. So, yeah. sir, help us understand, how is policy aiming to recognize these outstanding teachers who will be incentivized or rewarded?
Yeah, in fact, whenever I think of this question, I really laugh, I'll say. The reason is that, yes, policy has been talking about that, yeah, we need to incentivize, we need to motivate, we need to have provisions to attract best minds. Or the teachers who are doing great. Well, see, there are some, you know, more systematic problem, and here I comes to. I mean, and let me first talk about what policy is talking about. So, for example, policy talks about that we should have more transparent transfer policy. We should have housing facilities for the teachers within the campus. We should have. You know, other kind of incentives. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So these all things are there, but the problem is, you know, when we talk about the best mind at first level, at the entry level, you see, do you ever wonder that the people who are preparing for the IIT exam or for the medical, they are preparing to get a good housing facility? At the place where they work? I don't think so. Or any other thing which the policy is, in fact, and you know, envisaging to attract, you know, best talent. So I feel that this is something not in sync with what policy itself is, you know, talking about attracting. With housing facility, you cannot attract. Well, at one place, policy is also talking about peer review, and you know, the appraisal would be based on several factors. It is going to you know, do away with the practices of you know, kind of fixed increment which used to take place as of now in most of the government sector. These are welcome move, but the problem with this is that, you know, peer review or performance appraisals, these are required, but for this we need a highly professional environment. So at one hand, which I will be talking later, at one hand, when we are in fact ensuring a complete deprofessionalization of teachers, and on the other hand, we are saying that we will use those parameters to assess the teacher and incentivize them, which are used in highly professional environment, how is it going to work? I don't think that there is a sync between the two, because there are you know, a number of provisions which will eventually lead to a greater deprofessionalization of teachers, and then assessing and incentivizing them on the parameters of a highly professionalized environment, I don't think that it's going to be something you know, better. It's rather will take to a more worsening situation. Yeah.
So, like you talked about peer review, interestingly, policy also talks about one-on-one peer tutoring to be extremely effective for learning.
Yeah.
So, according to you, what will be the role of the teacher here? Will the teaching be dialogical in nature, democratic, or hierarchical?
Yeah, this is very interesting. I mean, see, what I have been talking about at other places also. This seems and this sounds very great, peer tutoring, right? And there are people who advocate that it works also. Yeah, it works. But the problem with this is that, again, what I told in the beginning, that it re-emphasizes the already hold belief in India that anyone can teach. When we say peer tutoring, bring people who are educated, who are senior, and take their help in teaching and learning, foundational skills of numeracy, literacy to younger kids, because policy identifies there are a large number of students who are not, having basic foundational skills in numeracy and literacy. That is fine. But what I'm arguing here that, in India, the NER, net enrollment ratio, is 100%. It means all children who are in the school-going age, they're coming to a school. And if they are still not able to have basic numeracy and literacy skills, it means their experiences of learning are not good. And the people who are involved in giving them, teaching them those foundational skills, they are not well trained. So now, when we are further suggesting that, fine, bring more people who are having no training in teaching and engage them in, for that peer tutoring, how is it going to serve? So at two level, at one level, that they have no training, and it further emphasizes on already hold belief that anybody can teach. It is also demeaning the profession of teaching, I will say, that anyone can teach. So if you are educated, let's come, go and do a peer tutoring. And this is the reason that people largely hold a belief that what these teachers are doing, OIE to sikhate in Hindi, they call it. And then how can we expect the kind of dignity, the kind of respect which the teacher needs to work under this profession? And any profession would not be able to attract good people unless the profession ensures dignity and respect. So I'm not saying here that for that region that anybody can teach and they should be allowed to teach. What I'm saying that anybody cannot teach, even teaching basic numeracy, basic literacy skills, it needs a lot of training, it needs competencies, it needs certain skills which anyone cannot possess. So everyone who can read and write cannot teach other person read and write. This is how I think.
When we talk about status, we definitely attribute the qualities of respect and dignity. Also, yeah. Autonomy comes into picture.
Absolutely.
So do you think that the teacher should have autonomy to choose which textbook she can opt that best suits her pedagogy or her students' needs?
Well, the matter of autonomy with teacher, it's a very complicated issue for them. And I'll say that perhaps there could be other profession I might not be aware of, but in terms of the profession of teaching, we perhaps could not move much ahead of how the colonial administration thought of teaching, the last rung in the bureaucratic structure. So, in a bureaucratic structure, you do not and you cannot imagine of kind of autonomy. So, there's a lot of focus on accountability and there's less focus on autonomy. So choosing which textbook or which material a teacher would be able to, choose or would be able to use in his or her classroom, it's a very, at this point of time, I'll say it's a very kind of utopian. For that, we have to trust in teachers, we have to invest in teachers, we have to invest in great, in-service and pre-service teacher training colleges and programs. As of now, there are provisions to just, more scrutiny, more accountability, and less of autonomy. So I don't think at this point of time, such provisions are going to be there to encourage teachers to use, the textbook, because it's not just a textbook or a classroom material. It's because through the learning contents or material or resources which the teachers are using in the classroom, basically states controls a kind of narrative which they want students to learn and believe in. So this is just not a matter of the teacher's autonomy. It's a larger issue, I think. It's between how a state wants a generation to believe in his kind of narratives, and vis-a-vis teachers' autonomy. So teachers' autonomy, the issue of teachers' autonomy is not so easy to understand, I think. And this is why, because it's the state which makes regulations, which determine, you know, service conditions, they won't allow, easily to teachers to use any materials they want to teach, because through this, they control the narratives.
So the policy also talks about how the teacher will be not now given the non-academic work. But don't you think that policy contradicts itself when it puts halt on the transfer of teachers, but at the same time talk about circulating teachers in school complex to maintain the adequate number of teachers or to enhance the vibrant teacher community?
Yeah, this is also very interesting. So I'll say very smartly, things have been written and worded. I have written about this, on my blog also, that unfortunately, none of the policy, forget about this new education policy, even earlier RTE, which got implemented in 2010, and even previous policies of 1986, 1968, none of the policy, has actually shown any serious concern about teachers' non-academic work. Yeah, they have shown the concern that the teachers have to do non-academic work, and this is not something good. And then they'll add a clause that fine, something of, constitutional duties of election or duties which comes under the disaster management, that they have to perform that. But it doesn't make a much difference. You know, the problem with the teachers are that anyone who can impose or who can, order that these are the work you need to do, they decide what teachers need to do, because since in the bureaucratic structure, they are the last point, so they don't have much autonomy in it. In this policy, very cleverly it's written that teachers should not be engaged in extraneous non-teaching job or extraneous administrative job. So this word is very beautiful, extraneous. What does it mean? That they can be engaged in any less extraneous one. And what would be the less extraneous? That would be decided by anyone who is in the position to impose or to direct. So for example, if a teacher are asked to go and do a household survey of 100 houses, 95 could be less extraneous, right? So very cleverly things have been written. Yeah, and you also asked about a school complex. This is also, I'll say that very, very smartly, and there is much more thing behind this idea of a school complex. See, I have spent my, a lot of time, I'll say first 20 years in a village, and I have studied in a village school. The whole idea of a school complex is that, it is difficult to provide so much resources in a school, and so there should be a school complex. So there would be a sharing of resources, there would be sharing of teachers. Now, if I look it from two point of view, one, as a village student studying in a village school, so like I was going to a high school which was like three kilometers away from my village, and often during the month of rainy season, the roads used to be flooded, and it used to become extremely difficult to go, and most often we didn't go. So is the situation in the hilly regions. So even if there is a school complex, it becomes extremely difficult for students to move from one village to other village. So when we say school complex, at one point I see it as government's intent to withdraw resources and commitment to provide good quality education to all the children of this country. So, which has been a kind of fundamental commitment of the government towards the children of this country. So I see with this provision a withdrawal to that fine, no, I'm not now responsible for this. If you want a good education, you have to come to a school complex. So like government is saying that, we are not responsible that if your school has not enough number of teachers, if your school does not have enough number of equipments, labs, right? Now we will provide all these things in a school complex. So at this point, I see a bigger problem with this idea. The second thing is, in the school complex, what would be the number of school? That has not been determined.
Yes.
So I also see it as another move to basically further, you know, a kind of deprofessionalized teachers. That fine, two school, three school, four school, five school together can hire the teacher. So there won't be a need of permanent teacher in a school. And we often develop, you know, kind of belongingness or what we call a vibrant community to a place where we go regularly, when we meet people, when we share staff room with them. A teacher moving from one school to other school and on everyday basis, which kind of vibrant community would they develop and would they be part of? It's really, I don't think, I mean, how has it been imagined? So it's the idea of a school complex is exactly against all such things which it is stating as its objective.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Your response really prompts us to read between the lines. So, sir, help us understand. Initially, B.Ed. program was for 1 year. Then it became a 2-year program. Now the policy is making it for 4 years. What do you think, what changes it will bring in the B.Ed. curriculum?
Yeah, it was, you know, the need was felt that the 1 year, which is basically 8 to 9 month program. It was not enough to prepare teachers who has to deal with so many things. Because, you know, teaching always involves philosophy, psychology, sociology, history. So you are teaching anything, you know, like science, mathematics, irrespective of it. So why you are teaching something that brings philosophy, how that brings psychology. It always draw upon the disciplines. So it was felt that it's not enough that in 8 to 9 months you will be able to prepare good teachers. So you need more time, so 2 years. And then it was decided that to have a kind of compact programs, which is 4 year on the line of other professional degrees like engineering or MBBS, which is 5-year integrated program, engineering four year integrated program. So now this B.Ed. is like B.A. B.Ed. So one does not go need to go for a separate bachelor's degree and then for a B.Ed. degree. So I mean, this is along with 2-year B.Ed. program, 1-year B.Ed. program. So I feel that it's good. I mean, there are multiple opportunities for people. So like those who have a bachelor's degree and they want to come for a B.Ed. program, they can go for 2 year. After 12, some of them can decide and they can go for the 4-year program. I think this is good. And what is more interesting that with this provision of 4-year one, more colleges and universities which were so far engaged only on providing bachelor's degree in more regular subjects, regular disciplines like history or science subjects or commerce subjects, they would be able to now, offer it along with the B.Ed. So there will be more college and universities in the position to offer this program along with their B.A. programs or B.Com or B.Sc. programs. So I feel that this is a good move. There is a concern which I have heard, but I'm not much aware of, that is a disciplinary concern that if a student is not going for the honors, you know, a kind of rigor which is needed to develop an understanding in a particular discipline, and it would be like the mix of everything because of its integrated B.Ed. program. So how that disciplinary understanding of a subject would develop. So that is a concern which some of the professors have raised, but I feel it's comparatively better. Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for engaging so deeply with the questions. And without taking much of your time, since you have written so extensively on the issues of teachers' deprofessionalization, do you have any concluding thoughts on how NEP envisages it further?
I have been realizing that this is something which is a deeper question which every teacher need to engage with. In fact, not only teacher, with everyone. Because, if in India, if we can imagine anything other than cricket, which everybody is interested in, that is good quality education. So whether rich or poor, people, from across the region or any other differences, they all are interested in a good quality education. So this is something. And I very strongly believe that no system of education can rise above the quality of its teachers. So at one hand, we all are interested in good quality education, and other hand, we also believe and we need to understand that no system of education can rise above the quality of its teachers. So the question of teachers has to be brought to the central issues of discussion and concern. Well, when I say deprofessionalization, what do I mean by it? That the trend, which I don't say that this NEP has started, which has been coming for last now 2-3 decades. I mean, it started in 90s, that we do not need, highly educated, well-trained, eligible teachers. We can get this work done by anyone else. Most of the NGOs involve people for this work, and as through peer tutoring or, several ways. So when we try to replace highly skilled people with less skill or no skilled people, it's a process of deprofessionalization. And what the problem is that, it shows that we still imagine teaching as the work of technicians. You tell it and they do it. But this is not exactly it is. But unfortunately, the people in management and in bureaucracy, they think that the solutions comes through technology, solution comes through management, and then they rush to micromanaging the things, that they will tell everything, what to teach, where to stand, when to pause, which question to ask, everything. That's the micromanagement. But unfortunately, this is not happening in the classroom. Those classrooms have become mechanical, very boring, and if you talk to the students, they are not very much interested in such kind of teaching learning. Neither teacher are interested in this kind of environment. Teaching is still a kind of intimate work, teaching and learning. We learn through intimacy when there is a relation between the student and the teacher, and it's a work of the imagination. And no amount of technology or managerial provisions can force teacher to imagine. For that, we have to professionalize teachers. We have to believe in teachers. We have to believe that if there is a problem in the classroom, it's teachers who will bring solution, not the management, not the technology. It's for the solution of a particular problem which is located in a classroom lies within the imagination of teacher and the students of that classroom. And this is why we need professionals in the classroom. And when I see it, what we are seeing these days, that the students is scoring 90%, 95%, they are committing suicide. I mean, what's wrong with them? They got the marks, but still they are committing suicide. So this is the outcome of this mechanical classroom which we have created through deprofessionalization of teachers. So if we have to claim a teaching learning, which is, something which is the demand of, every heart, which people enjoy, where learning really takes place, for that we have to professionalize teachers. And when I see that there are provisions in the NEP which further envisages deprofessionalization, most of this we have already spoken, that you also mentioned that this peer tutoring is one which further envisages for deprofessionalization. Higher level of privatization that also leads to deprofessionalization, because it has been seen that it's the private schools, not in the big cities, but in the suburbs and in the rural areas, that they hire teachers on low wages. So all such provisions, when we look at, we see that the policy is actually not recognizing teachers as professionals, and not. And the biggest example is policy nowhere talks about teachers as a researcher, that the teachers can also research and learn from their own resources and further contribute in the knowledge contribution about school education. So these, I have written extensively about it. So that is my concern, that as I told you, that no system of education can rise above the quality of its teachers. So for a better education system, we have no any other way but to professionalize our teachers, to trust them, believe in them, let them imagine the solutions of the challenges which we have in our school education. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I think it's right time to take our teachers and their teaching seriously. Thank you so much, sir, for your time. We are humbled and truly grateful. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed it a lot. Thanks a lot.
Me too, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
That is all for today. We will be back with another episode shortly. This podcast is brought to you by the Center for Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Thank you for listening. Have a good day.